This is a Louis T. Network exclusive.
Hey, either you're outside or you're
in the lab room.
Draft Zone.
Huh? Could it be? Me, you're me, Louis T. Welcome, you are in the lab room. Of course, I'm your host, Lou. Thank you for joining me on the 2016 NFL Draft Wrap-Up Series, where your man, Louis T, aims to break down all 32 teams in the National Football League's 2016 NFL Draft using our baseball grayscale single, double, triple, home run. There are no strikeouts here in the Draft Wrap-Up Series, because we cannot tell how these players are going to pan out, and I don't want to discount any of these young men before they get their chance in the National Football League. And so we'll get a score for each and every player selected in said team's draft, total up those scores, apply bonuses when necessary, divide by the number of picks, which will then yield us an overall final grade for that team's draft. We'll then move on to the next team in the series picked by you. That's right, you the viewer are in total control, as this is the you pick format, or as I like to call it, the up format. Simply be the first to leave a comment in the comment section of this and future videos stating two things: the team you want to see next and the phrase itself, next. So make sure that the phrase next and the team you'd like to see next is in the comment section of the video, and you're first to do so, and that team will be up next in the series. Sounds simple enough? That's because it is, and you guys have done a phenomenal job of doing that this year, probably the best job you've done thus far, so haven't had any complaints in that department. And because of you out there, the next team up in this series is none other than the Seattle Seahawks, a team that has been hovering around the Super Bowl for the last 3 years or so. Last year was the first year that they weren't able to get that done. But you look at where they are, and we keep asking ourselves, when are the Seahawks going to fall off? When are they going to hit that proverbial wall, not make the postseason, and go back into a sort of transitional phase where they're trying to figure out what they need to do to get back to the playoffs? Hasn't happened yet. It's a young team, young quarterback. You feel like no more Marshawn Lynch. Maybe this could be the year. Maybe this could be the season when they hit that proverbial wall and they don't make the postseason, and someone else in that division, maybe the Rams or some other team, maybe the 49ers, hits their stride again, or something of that sort happens, and they overtake the Seahawks in this division along with the Cardinals to make the postseason. But you really don't know until it actually happens. And I tell you what, they continue to draft well in Seattle. And this is another one of those drafts where you look up and you say, man, they did a damn good job. And let's talk about this draft, because if you continue to have drafts the way the Seahawks had them, and you continue to be coached up the way that Pete Carroll coaches them up, it's going to be pretty tough for this team to fall off that cliff that everybody's waiting for them to potentially fall off of. Let's look at this draft in 2016 of the Seattle Seahawks. Now, first round, 32nd overall selection, Texas A&M offensive lineman Jermaine Ifedi is the selection. Remember, Seahawks traded back with the Denver Broncos, allowed the Broncos to come up, get Paxton Lynch. They move back to 32 and pick up some picks and take an offensive lineman. We know the offensive line was a source of frustration for the Seahawks last year. So you knew they were going to spend some resources on that position, and they definitely did that throughout this draft, as you will find out once I continue to break it down. But 6'6", 324 pounds, a tremendous length, 36-inch arms. This guy has vines for arms, and he's got an NFL tackle build. So this is a guy you look at and you say, he projects as a tackle at the next level. If you just look at him, he has the build and the physical makeup of a guy that should step right in and be your right tackle, your left tackle, and do it for some time. A powerful offensive lineman is the next pro. This is a guy that is big, he's built, he's physical. I was watching him against Alabama, and there's one play, I think it's Duval, the defensive end slash outside linebacker, is on a rush, and Jermaine Ifedi literally takes him, drives him back about 2 or 3 yards, and then just pancakes him. I mean, literally puts him on his back. Something probably happened. Duval probably slipped, but it doesn't matter. He put him down on his back and then pancaked him, put a little bit of extra syrup on top, and that's what you can get out of this guy. He's a big physical guy that can move grown men, and so this is the type of player that the Seahawks definitely need. quick on his feet in passing sets. This is the guy to get out of the blocks, sets up shot quickly, and is able to really give himself a chance to set his feet, get a quick base in there, and be able to stand up at the point of attack. Good recovery. With those 36-inch arms, you get a guy that can initially not do what he's supposed to do because there are some inconsistencies with Jermaine Ifedi, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on. But there's opportunity for him to initially not win, but because of his great length that we talked about, those 36-inch vines he has for arms, he can still get back into the play, whether it's inside or outside. It's not always clean, okay? A lot of times you see him and it kind of looks like a hold that he may get away with, but he can recover at the end of the day, whether the officials call it or not, it's up to them. But he can recover even when he's beaten because he's such a long offensive lineman. Picks up stunts and twists very easily. It was so clean and effortless that I had to rewind it just watching to say, wow, I mean, he made it look easy with pass guys off inside and the guy coming looping around. He'd be just standing there waiting on them. And sometimes it's amazing. Some of these offensive linemen make these twists and stunts look so hard to pick up. Like, man, why did you do that? I mean, how did you make that look so bad? He makes it look so easy, and he's never confused. I never once saw him confused or baffled by a stunt or a twist. He was always right there waiting on that defender to come around, and he'd pick him up, no problems, no questions asked. The last two pros, versatility and bloodlines. This is a guy that played offensive line for the first year at Texas A&M. First couple of years, I should say, at Texas A&M, protecting Johnny Manziel. And then the last 2 years playing right tackle. The assumption was, and you know how it's been over the last few years, this has been a factory at Texas A&M at the left tackle position. It started off with Luke Jokel in the first round. And you had Luke Jokel at left tackle and you had Matthews at right tackle. Jokel gets selected in the top five of the NFL draft. Then Matthews slides over to left tackle. In goes Cedric Abuehi at right tackle. Matthews gets selected in the first round, top 10, slides over to left tackle, does Cedric Abuehi. And then inserted at right tackle is Jermaine Ifedi. And then Cedric Abuehi, because of his injury, goes in the top 25 of the draft, but probably would have been a top 10, top 15 pick had he not gotten injured last year, but he still gets selected in the first round. And the assumption was Jermaine Ifedi would slide right over to the left tackle and the train would keep moving at Texas A&M at the left tackle position. But they decided not to do that with him. And there are a couple of reasons why. We'll talk about that when we get there. But he's a guy with versatility, can play guard or tackle. And that's the question. What are the Seahawks gonna do with him? It's always, to me, not a question of whether you go guard or tackle with the guy, especially when they have the body and the build to do it and the athleticism. You go tackle absolutely first, and if they prove to you they can't do it, then you go guard. Similar to Brandon Scherff. You take him as a tackle, you put him at tackle, and if he shows you or gives you any reason to doubt at tackle, you move him inside the guard and you get yourself a solid football player at a position on your offensive line, because the Seahawks can use players all up and down that offensive line anyhow. And bloodlines. His brother Martin Ifedi last year was selected in the NFL draft out of Memphis. And so this is a guy with some NFL bloodlines. Again, that stuff doesn't go unnoticed by NFL scouts. So anytime you get a family that seems to be a factory, you love it because you say, hey, this is in their DNA. These guys can get it done. And he's another one in the Ifedi line playing football. So you go to cons. Technique flaws is the first one, and the next con kind of goes with the first one, so I'll kind of lump them together. Inconsistencies is the next con. So the first con, technique flaws, with Jermaine Ifedi, you'll get some technical flaws and issues, and this is why this is such a good pick, because with the Cable Guy, Tom Cable, as your offensive line coach, you know he's going to clean up and smooth up those edges. Some of those edges are rough with Jermaine Ifedi, and Tom Cable's gonna smooth those edges out and turn this guy into the type of player you need to protect Russell Wilson. And I look at his technical flaws, and the first thing is his base. His feet are everywhere, especially after he gets out of his set. Usually once he gets out of his stance, it's clean, but once he starts shuffling, the feet get narrow and he doesn't have a great base, and that's sometimes you'll see him get pushed back into the quarterback. Then the hand placement is horrible, okay? His hands are all over the place. A lot of times they're out here on the shoulder pads. I'm surprised he didn't get called for holding a lot more often, because there are times when guys spin and he's literally grabbing their neck and he's grabbing their shoulder. Almost look like he's trying to put them in some kind of choke hold or sleeper hold. His hands are everywhere. They're never in the same spot twice, which it should be right up in here somewhere. He's got arms out here, arms around the neck. His hand placement is horrible, which gets him beat sometimes, especially when a guy's athletic, speed rush with some hands. You can beat Jermaine Ifedi. So the inconsistencies that you see with him, because you don't get the same hand placement twice in a row, because his base isn't set consistently enough, this isn't a guy that I think they're comfortable with putting him at left tackle. And that's what I talked about earlier. The assumption was they were going to slide him over to left tackle once Cedric Oboehi moved on to the NFL, but they didn't do that because I don't think they were comfortable enough with Jermaine Ifedi and the way he plays. So they left him at right tackle, and he performed well for them, but it wasn't up to the standard that they had set for themselves and really what had been set before him at left tackle, so they kept him at right tackle. So that's something to keep in mind as we move on to his final con. Pre-snap movement. I'm not sure if it's just me or is this guy moving early. Now, there were a couple of times he was actually flagged for moving early before the snap, but it seems like he gets out of his stance way too early. It seems like he's just a hair early before the snap, and it seemed like he got away with it quite a bit. That's something to keep an eye on. I saw him with a boatload of pre-snap penalties, and I thought he could have had a bunch more. So that's just something to keep in mind. I'd like to see him be a little bit more synchronized with the snap. I think he's a little early. I think he got away with it in college. I don't know if he's going to get away with that at the next level, so we'll see with Jermaine Ifedi. But this is a really solid pick for them. They needed to do this. They needed to improve the offensive line. And they did that in the first round, 32nd overall selection. Texas A&M offensive lineman Jermaine Ifedi for me is a triple. I question whether this guy is going to play tackle or guard at the next level. I think it's tackle. You try him at tackle first. If it doesn't work, then you slide him inside. I don't know if he's the left tackle of the future or not. I seriously doubt that, but we're going to see. I think they're going to give him every opportunity to be a left or a right tackle day one. And then if it doesn't work, they're going to kick him inside. One thing's for sure, this guy's going to start for you in his rookie season, day one, barring any kind of injury. This guy's going to be on the football field for you in Seattle. He moves on to the second round, 49th overall selection. Alabama defensive lineman Jaron Reed is the selection. And this is an excellent selection for the Seattle Seahawks. You lose Brandon Mebane. The defensive line needed to be retooled somewhat. The guys have been leaving this defensive line, seems like, for the last couple of years in free agency. So this is a really good get for you. And I talked about Jaron Reed not being a first-round pick and not being a first-round caliber defensive lineman, but I didn't think he would fall to damn near 50 in the draft. So to see this guy on the board, and I think the Seahawks said the same thing to themselves, because remember, they traded up to get him at 49. This was not their pick. So they saw this guy falling down the draft board a bit, and they said, hey, we're going to stop this slide right now. Let's go up and get him before somebody else snatches him up. And they watched A'shaun Robinson come off the board to the Lions at around 46 or so, 44, somewhere in there. And they said, hey, the other one's there. Let's go get him. And I thought he was the better of the two, if you ask me. So I feel like you're getting a consistent football player who's going to step in, a hard hat, lunch pail, do the dirty work. But also, I feel like he can get better as a defensive lineman. I don't know if he'll ever be a seven-sack guy in the interior. But one thing's for sure, he's going to hold up his end of the bargain in the run game. And I absolutely love his game. And I thought he was a fringe first-round pick. I didn't think he needed to be a first-round pick, but I thought someone else would feel froggy enough to leap in the back end of the first round, maybe the beginning of the second round. And for him to be there at the midpoint of the second round, to me, is tremendous value for a team that desperately needed some help up front along that defensive line. So I think this is really going to help them kind of keep the ball rolling up in that front seven. We know how dominant that front seven has been for the Seattle Seahawks. We always talk about the Legion of Boom and the success that they have in that back half, but it all starts up front for the Seahawks, and this is a guy that's going to keep that ball rolling for them in Seattle. In the second round, 49th overall selection, Alabama defensive lineman Jaron Reed. Is it up? He's hit deep. You can put him on the board. Yes. It's a home run. in the second round for the Seattle Seahawks, as they got tremendous value again. I did not expect Jaron Reed to be here at 49 for the Seahawks to even move up and have a choice to select. I think this is great value. On top of that, you're getting a football player that is going to be steady. He's going to come in. He does have a dominant trait. It's not getting to the quarterback. It is stopping the run, and that's what this Seahawks team has done a really good job of, is stopping the run and forcing teams to have to beat them through the air, and that's when the Legion of Boom is able to step up and make some plays, and I think that's what Jaron Reed is going to do, and I think he can actually get better as a pass rusher as he continues in his journey towards the NFL, and let's see if he can go ahead and take it up a notch and start getting after quarterbacks at the next level, more so than he did at Alabama. You go to the third round, 90th overall selection. Notre Dame running back CJ Procise is the selection. This is a guy that, you know, I absolutely loved throughout the process. And I talked about him being on the Louis T all wish list team. And this was a guy that I wanted my Redskins to select because of his different layers of his game. We'll talk about all of those things. 6 feet, 220 pounds. A tremendous athlete, 4.48 40. This is a guy with some speed, and you see this tremendous and ridiculous burst, which is the next pro. This is a guy that, you just give him a little bit of space, and all of a sudden he hits that second level, and he's just running by guys, and you're not seeing anyone catch up with him. I think about the Clemson game, the catch down the sidelines, and he just runs past everybody, scores a touchdown. I think about the Georgia Tech game, 93-yard run. They give him the football, he hits a crease, and he runs by the entire Georgia Tech football team en route to a 93-yard touchdown. I think about the UMass game. He gets the football, makes a cut, gets to the outside, gets up the sideline, and is gone. This is the type of speed that he has, and he's a guy that has a tremendous burst. And once he hits that hole, gets that seam, not a lot of guys are tracking down CJ Procise from behind. I can also remember in 2014 in the bowl game versus LSU with the big run for a touchdown, which I think gave Brian Kelly and the Notre Dame coaching staff the idea, let's put this guy at the running back position and give him some carries and see what he's about. And through injuries, he got the football a lot more than they had intended for him to, but he went out and performed big for the Notre Dame Fighting Irish in the past season. Holy Trinity is the next pro. He's got the Holy Trinity at the running back position. My Holy Trinity, of course, vision, balance, feet. He's got all three. He's got the ability to see the cut, make the cut, and go and stay on his feet. Sometimes you got to make some sharp cuts as a running back. Sometimes you got to have that balance, because if you make that sharp cut with those feet, and again, feet, balance, vision are the three, the Holy Trinity. You see it. Got to be able to get there, and when you get there, got to be able to keep your feet. Sometimes you make that sharp jump cut or whatever the case may be. Got to be able to keep your balance. And so he does all of those things extremely well. EADer. He's an EADer as a receiver. Equally as dangerous out of the backfield. This is a guy that, keep in mind, was a receiver at one point at Notre Dame for 2 years. And so this is a guy that they had at receiver. He first came to Notre Dame as a safety, so keep this in mind. He was initially a safety, comes to Notre Dame, they move him to wide receiver, he plays the receiver position for 2 years, they move him to running back after seeing him make some explosive plays, a couple of injuries happen, he hits the field, he never looks back at the running back position. So this is a guy that essentially played the running back position for just 1 year, so he still got that receiver in him, so he's just as good as a receiver out of the backfield as he is a running back. So there's a lot here with CJ Procise. He will protect in pass pro. I mean, I think he can get better at it, but I love the way he sticks his face in there. Again, playing the defensive side of the football and coming to Notre Dame as a safety recruit. Again, this is a guy that is physical, has a level of physicality to him, so he's not afraid to stick his nose in there and meet a defender head on. He's not one of these guys looking to cut everybody. He will stick his face mask in the chest of a blitzing linebacker, safety, whomever. Versatility, I just talked about the versatility, so I don't really need to harp on it much more. Came to Notre Dame as a safety, played receiver for 2 years, and then made the transition to running back. So this is a guy with some unique skill sets, and I think the most incredible thing about him is, before he hit the running back fame that he saw last year, this was a guy that was a standout on special teams And so I think that that's another element, and you go to his final pro, special teams value that you get with CJ ProSize. This is a guy that steps in day one, and I don't assume that he's going to be the starting running back. I think there's going to be some serious competition because we saw what Thomas Rawls did last year before the injury. You got another running back that I think could easily step in and be your starting running back. And then you got CJ ProSize. I don't know how these carries are going to be divvied up, but I think that's a great problem to have in any event with Marshawn Lynch no longer being there. So I love the fact that this guy can step in day one and give you some serious production as a special team standout. And in some form or fashion is going to see the field offensively and help you, whether he's catching it out of the backfield in the screen game, running some routes out of the backfield, or simply being in to tote the rock. So there's some serious versatility here, and he gives you some special team value in the process. You go to his cons. He's raw. I talked about it already, which isn't a bad thing necessarily, because I feel like he can get better as a running back. There's some things that he does need to clean up. We'll talk about them here in a second. But him only playing the running back position for 1 year, there's still a lot to learn for CJ ProSize at that position. So even though he has some things that I love, there's also some things that I think he needs to clean up and become better at. Speaking of which, he has a tendency to want to bounce runs outside, which he has the speed to do that. But sometimes I feel like there's still more meat on the bone to the outside on these runs. There's still sometimes where I feel like there's some more yards to be gained just keeping straight. And he prefers to bounce it outside. Now he has the speed to get outside, but sometimes at this next level that he's going to in the National Football League, where you bounce stuff out, there's guys with just as much speed, if not more so, than you. You're not getting around that corner. Whereas he was able to turn the corner at Notre Dame, when you're running by guys that play at UMass and Georgia Tech, you can do that. The game's going to change now when you go to the NFL and these defensive linemen are running, you know, 4.5s, and these linebackers are running 4.4s, and these safeties and corners are running 4.3s. It's going to be tough for you to turn that corner and make some plays. So we'll see if that's something that comes back to haunt him. And sometimes he presses the hole too long. Sometimes he just needs to stick his foot in the hole, in the ground, and turn up the field and get what's there. And sometimes he likes to kind of press the hole a little bit too long, and next thing you know, somebody tracks him down from the backside, or he's just a little bit too patient there. When there's yardage to be gained, sometimes it's not going to be blocked up the way. You can't just wait and wait and wait and think that something's gonna. Sometimes the defense just wins up front, and you gotta stick your foot in the ground and make something happen. Sometimes I think he's a little bit hesitant to do that. He's thinking something's gonna pop free. If I just keep pressing this hole, finally runs out of real estate, somebody tracks him down, and next thing you know, it's a 2-yard loss. He needs to be a little bit more aggressive in attacking the line of scrimmage. And finally, ball security. Again, coming from the receiver position, used to be a defender, sometimes a ball isn't as secure as it needs to be. So that's just something I feel like he needs to clean up. You know, a few fumbles it's never a good time to fumble, okay? Let me clear that up. But there's some inopportune fumbles at Notre Dame for CJ ProSize. Sometimes where he wasn't even contacting the ball, shook free, just needs to be better with the ball security. I think that's something they'll clean up at the next level. But in the third round, 90th overall selection, Notre Dame running back CJ ProSize for me is a triple. This is a guy that I think is going to come in, compete for some reps at the running back position right away. I think he's going to be a special team standout for you right away. And I think this is a guy that, you know, down the road could easily be your starting running back. But I tell you this much, he's going to see the football out of the backfield because this guy is a dangerous threat when on the field. And I think they're going to utilize him in Seattle. We move on to the next third round pick, 94th overall, Ohio State tight end. Nick Vanette is the selection. I've already broken him down in the draft prospects 101 series as I did with Jaron Reed. But I will say this, I think he is a home run blocker right away. I mean, you get a guy that comes in right now. And we talk about Ezekiel Elliott all the time and how dominant he was at Ohio State. This is a guy that I thought paved the way for him. A lot of those big runs, that last block, that kickout block that sent him on his way, done by Nick Vanette. And a lot of the damage done on the ground came behind a Nick Vanette block at Ohio State. So right now, you ask me, one of the best blocking tight ends in this entire draft class. So from a blocking standpoint, The guy is a home run for me. And I think he's an underrated pass catcher while we're on the subject matter of Nick Van Dyke, because I don't think people give him enough credit for his ability to catch the football. No, not the greatest athlete in the world, not outrunning anybody. But if you throw him the football, I feel confident in saying Nick Van Dyke's going to catch it. I think he can get open. He's a big target. Love what he brings to the table in Seattle. And I think he's going to be a guy that comes in and makes a difference right away as well. In the third round, 94th overall selection, Ohio State. The Ohio State University tight end, Nick Van Dyke, is another triple. Really love this selection and what he brings to the table. I think he has a niche that he can carve out for himself day one as a hell of a blocker. And he's going to get a bone or two tossed his way as well. And when he does, he's going to make the most of those opportunities. You move on to the third round. Yet again, three third round selections for the Seahawks. 97th overall selection, Boise State offensive lineman Reese Adiambo is the selection. 6'4", 314 pounds. Solid length, 33 inches, and good movement skills. Really was surprised at how well he moved because of the noise I heard on Reese Adiambo coming out of the draft was, this guy's a guard, this guy's a guard, this guy's a guard. And I watched him, and I said, the only thing that I saw initially that made him a guard was he's probably not the longest defender, offensive lineman, because, you know, a lot of these guys are 6'5", 6'6", 6'7", coming out of the, you know, out of the package. You open it up, you take them out of the package, and these guys are 6'7", you know, 6'6", with 34, 35-inch arms. Well, he's 6'4", with 33-inch arms, which isn't bad, but it's not great. But the movement skills, I assume when someone tells me, hey, this guy's a guard, he's a guard, he's a guard, that, okay, he's not moving very well. No, this guy moves well. So I'm like, huh. You know, I watched him against Utah State and Kyler Fackrell and company. You know, I watched him against Virginia, and I'm saying to myself, this guy's moving well, so what's the deal? You know, he generates movement in the run game, especially on double teams. That's the next pro. I mean, he's moving, guys. I mean, he's doing an excellent job of locking on to defenders and moving them in the run game at times. You know, we'll talk about that a little bit later on, but I just thought he did some good things to help some, you know, runs spring out of the backside of plays. They had a running back named McNichols, a little small guy with some speed, especially in the Virginia game. He's cutting back, and Reese Adiambo's block is the one that seals off that edge on that cutback, and boom, he was going for some big yardage and some chunk plays off that edge. So I thought he did some good things on those double teams. He gets off that double team, gets to the second level, and he was putting a body on some guys. Versatility, offensive guard, offensive tackle. He's played both at college at Boise, so he's able to do both, and I think that's the question. Tackle, guard. I think we already know the answer to that question, but I still think there's a debate there to be had. You move on to his cons. Doesn't sustain blocks. That was the thing that drove me nuts with Reese Adiambo, is that he would initially win. I mean, literally, he would be in great position. He'd fire off the ball, and he'd have a guy, and he'd let him go. Like, I couldn't understand why he would keep doing this, because I'm saying to myself, dude, you're doing the hardest part, which is literally getting your body and getting yourself in a position to win. You've done that already. Just finish the block. Don't let him go. And as soon as the running back would come, he let him go. Literally, like, it was easy to stack and shed him, because you'd have the defensive lineman, and you're like, man, he's got a great base. Hands are right where they need to be. All he needs to do is turn this defensive lineman. All he needs to do is turn this linebacker, and he's got him. And he would never turn him. He would never angle himself. He would never square his shoulders and turn his feet and his butt. And that defensive lineman, linebacker, whomever, just throw him out of the way, get to the ball carrier, and help make the tackle. And I'm saying, come on, Reese. You got to be better than that, bro. His size is also going to be a question. 6'4", 314 pounds. I mean, it's not bad size, but that's guard size, it seems like. Because their guys are so much bigger on the outside now. They're 6'5", they're 6'6". Like I said earlier, they've got longer arms. That's going to be a question. Can he stand up outside again? I'm more inclined to give a guy a shot outside at tackle, because if you need him, you can always find a guard. It's harder to find tackles. If this guy can play the tackle position, you put him there first. If he takes care of business out there, you leave him out there. If you go to tackle and you feel like, okay, he's not getting the job done, slide him inside the guard and you keep it moving. So I think that's going to be the thing with him, because of his size. That's the question you got to ask yourself. Then the next thing and the biggest thing is durability. Can he be available for this Seahawks football team? Because he wasn't always available at Boise. Never started more than 9 games in any given season while at Boise. Missed 5 games in 2013 due to an injury. Missed another 5 games in 2013 due to an injury. And so this is a guy that you really can't count on to stay healthy and be consistent on the football field. So that's the biggest question with Reeves Adhiambo is, can he stay healthy? We'll see. But this is another one of those guys that Tom Cable, the cable guy, will get his hands on. And they're hoping he can turn this guy into a masterpiece, much like Jermaine Ifedi. In the 3rd round, 97th overall selection, Boise State offensive lineman Reeves Adhiambo, for me, is a double. It probably would have been a little bit higher had he been able to stay healthy. But health is always a concern. When guys don't show the ability to stay healthy and play on the field, that's always a problem as you move on to the next level. So hopefully Reeves Adhiambo can show that he can stay healthy, because a guy that is able to play, availability is key, can show you some things. But a guy that's on the sideline taking mental reps in a jogging suit can't do much for you. And that's something that he's had an issue with at Boise State. You go to the 5th round, 147th overall selection, Maryland defensive tackle Quentin Jefferson is the selection. 6'4", 291 pounds, long defender with 33-inch arms, and, you know, which will help him. Again, this is a defensive line that needs to be replenished. Here's a guy that they feel like can come in and do some things. He's got good athleticism. It's a guy that ran a 4.9 5.40, so he's got some quick twitch in him. Flashes of elite quickness is the next pro. Every now and again, you will see Quentin Jefferson come off the ball, fire off the ball, get in the backfield. He's got a beautiful swim move, okay, that he wins with occasionally. And if he can just put it together consistently, this guy could be something. When you get 6.5 sacks from the interior position of the defensive line, you're doing some work. So this is a guy that you feel like could do some things. There's some inconsistencies in this game. His sack production wasn't spread out over the season. It was a couple of sacks here, a sack there. It was against lesser competition. When he played against the upper echelons, he didn't do much of anything. So I've got questions, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on. But he started the point of attack against single matchups. When he's singled up on a guard or a center, he styled as he can be. When he gets double teamed, you can move this guy, you can uproot him. And at times he would play the zero tech at Maryland. They would go with a 3-man front and he would be right over the center, and he would not stand up well to those double teams sometimes. Not all the time, but sometimes they would move him out of there. He'd be uprooted. Even when they were in 4-man fronts and he got double teamed by the guard and the center, I didn't think he held up all the time in those situations. But when it's a one-on-one matchup, he holds up as stout as anybody inside at that defensive tackle position. Let's go to his cons, because I was really disappointed in Quentin Jefferson. And there are a number of reasons why, and this was almost a single for me. His motor and his consistency. First of all, you know, I don't do motor dudes, okay? There's so many things that you can work on with a player, all right? But the one thing that should come prepackaged is a motor. You don't have to be talented to hustle, okay? That's something that you either do or you don't. And watching him, I scratch my head, because there are plays where I'm like, does he know the ball is snapped? I mean, what the hell is he doing? Now, was he tired? I don't know. I can't speak to whether he was tired or not. But I didn't always get effort out of this guy. I didn't feel like I was, at least. And that's the one thing, you know, I don't do. That's a pet peeve of mine. Don't you dare come up to me with some half-assed effort. That's the one thing I can't stand. So if you're going to perform, you need to do it at a high level. Every snap you're on the field, you tired, you tap the hell out. Get out the game. But don't be in the game giving me half-assed effort. And I felt like I was getting that from Quentin Jefferson from time to time. That's something that I just can't stomach. I don't do half-assed effort. That's the one thing. Because again, that's not something that needs to be coached. That's not something that you have to work on. Effort is there, okay? You got guys that are way less talented than a lot of these other guys, but the one thing you don't have to worry about is motor. They come out there and they give you everything they got. I don't necessarily get that from Quentin Jefferson. And because of that, there's a consistency issue here. Because this guy's talented enough to make more plays, but he doesn't. And I think some of that is tied to the fact that he's not going as hard as he should be all the time. You go to his next con, lack of serious production. I mean, last year, his 6.5 sacks was his best season by far. And some of it has to do with his injury history. But a lot of that has to do with the fact this dude just isn't giving you everything he's got on every single snap. And so I think there's a real question mark with him as to what he is. He could have went back to school for another year, decided to come out. He's got a family, wife, and some kids. So I think the lure of the NFL, plus he had already been there 4 years at Maryland, for him was, I think I'm ready to go. I think I'm ready to go. Start making some money. I got some family things that I need to take care of. Got a family to take care of. I think I need to go ahead and move on. I think I'm good enough, and he did. So good for him. But in 2014, he tore his ACL. That's another con. That I think had something to do with some of the production or lack thereof. But at the end of the day, for me, if this guy, because he's got talent, there's no doubt about it. If this guy can give you more effort, because there's some tools to work with here. He could be a borderline dominant player if he turns it up a notch. We'll see what happens with him. I was not overly impressed with what I saw, and a lot of that was because of the lack of consistent motor. But in the fifth round, 147th pick, Maryland defensive tackle, Quentin Jefferson, for me, is a double, and it was barely a double. But like I said, you don't get 6.5 sacks by just pure happenstance. All right, this is a guy that has some talent. The swim move is deadly when used correctly. There's some quickness here, just don't see it enough. Hopefully, at the next level, they're able to get there. And this is what the Seahawks do. They take these type of players that have the talent, but necessarily don't get the most out of that talent at the college level, and they turn these guys into stars at the next level. Let's see if they can't do that with Quentin Jefferson. We go to the next fifth round selection, 171st overall pick. Arkansas running back Alex Collins is the selection, 5'10". 217 pounds. Let me say this before I jump into his breakdown. To me, he was one of the most underrated backs in this draft class. I thought that if put in the right situation, he could be a star out of this draft class. And I said to myself, he's a wild card at the running back position. He lands in the right situation, he could be a star at the next level. And I think this could be the perfect situation for Alex Collins. Fluid athlete. You look at him, no wasted motion with Alex Collins. He's a north and south runner that gets up the field in a hurry. But when he decides to make a cut, he doesn't lose speed. So that's a beautiful thing there. And that's the fluidity that I'm talking about. He's one of these guys that you never really see him downshift. You never see him actually shift up a gear either. We'll talk about that a little bit later on. But he's just a fluid athlete. When he makes those jump cuts, they're easy, they're effortless. And he never breaks stride, which allows him to get up the field in a hurry. He plays a lot faster than his 40 time would indicate. Outstanding patience. He has patience about him as a runner, where he presses a hole or he allows a block to set up. He's not overly anxious to get to the line of scrimmage and get tackled. He allows things to develop. Then he hits the hole and he goes much faster than slow. So this is a guy that exudes and exhibits a lot of patience as a runner. And we all know you can be overly patient or you cannot be patient enough. He finds a nice balance there between being not, a guy that is overly anxious to get up there to the line of scrimmage, but also not too patient, like I talked about with CJ Prosise a little bit earlier on, where he's taking too long to hit the hole and allowing guys to come from the backside and get to him. Initial burst through the hole is tremendous. That's the next pro. He's a guy that, at Arkansas, they had a massive offensive line with Sebastian Chitrola and all of those guys that he was able to run behind. They created some creases, and when they would, he would take full advantage of that hole, get to the second level, get in the end zone. There were a bunch of 100-plus yard games for Alex Collins last year, and he's been a big production guy throughout his career. We'll talk about that here in a second, but this is a guy that when he gets an opportunity, a crease, he hits that hole, gets to the second level, and he can make some guys miss out in the secondary. Holy Trinity, he has it. Feet, balance, vision, has the entire package. So that's something else that he comes pre-equipped with. You don't have to teach him to look backside for a cut. You don't have to teach him to make those cuts. His feet are great. You can't teach a guy to make cuts anyhow. Either that's innate and something that they already have, or they don't. This guy can cut with the best of them. That jump cut is vicious that Alex Collins has. Forward lean. He runs with the forward lean, so when you hit this guy, he's going to fall forward for that extra yard. If it's 3rd and 5 and he gets a draw, and they love to run delays at Arkansas with him. That was one of their staple plays. He does such a great job. I talked about his patience. He sets up these runs, especially on these draws and these delays. He was outstanding at it. He's one of these guys that on 3rd and 5, you hand it to on a draw. The defense is looking for a pass. He comes and gets the football. Next thing you know, they tackle him 1 yard short. He leans forward, picks up the first down. That's part of the reason also with this forward lean that he had 20 touchdowns. A guy that has a nose for the end zone, which is another one of his pros, along with being a yakster. Yards after contact. With that forward lean, you get a guy that's picking up extra yards after contact. If you don't come with a form tackle, he won't be denied. This is a guy that I saw him, run through a bunch of arm tackles. He won't be afraid or hesitant to spin on a guy and spin out of a tackle. So there's a lot of yards after contact. You don't run for over 1,000 yards 3 consecutive years in the SEC, with last season being up over 1,500 yards. If you don't run with forward lean, don't run through arm tackles, and don't get yards after contact. So this is a guy that had a tremendous career at Arkansas under Brett Bielema. And go to his next pro. Solid in pass pro. I think he can get a little bit better at this, as the case with CJ ProSize, but one thing's for sure, he's not afraid to stick his nose in a defender's chest. So again, he's not afraid to go out there and put his body on the line, and that's usually half the battle with these running backs. He's not afraid, neither is CJ ProSize. So again, I'm not worried about this guy in pass pro. Fine tune some things here and there, and he'll be a guy that you can put on the field all 3 downs. And I talked about his collegiate production. That's his final pro. Here's a guy that I thought was a standout at Arkansas, and he was in a dual backfield along with Williams, and Williams goes down with an injury, a foot injury, in the offseason, right as the season is about to get underway. Can't perform in 2015, so literally the whole burden was placed on the shoulders of Alex Collins, and he stepped up to the plate and knocked it out of the park with over 1,500 yards rushing and 20 touchdowns. Again, they loved to run it at Arkansas, and they ran it with Alex Collins, and I thought he was huge for them, and I think he's going to be huge for the Seahawks as he continues on in his career. You go to his cons. Falls in love with the cutback. And this is a guy that I feel like he cuts it back prematurely sometimes, where there's more yards to be gained to the outside. He's always looking for a cutback. It doesn't matter. At the line of scrimmage, at the second level, he's always looking for a cutback. Sometimes there doesn't need to be a cutback. Just keep going outside. There's plenty of real estate out there and opportunity for a big play. And sometimes he decides to cut it back prematurely. If he can just learn when the cutback is necessary and when it's not, I think that's something that will take his game to even new heights at the next level. Monotone runner. Remember I talked about him not shifting gears necessarily? There's patience. But once he starts running, there's one speed and one speed only, okay? He's stuck in third gear, and he's not shifting up to fourth gear, fifth gear, none of that. This is a guy that I talked about never having to downshift, the cut, and anything like that. Doesn't lose stride, but he never changes speed. There's no hesitation, no stutter, none of that stuff. There's no 0 to 60 acceleration. Once he starts running, there's one speed and one speed alone. And so you won't see him outrun a guy because he turned it up a notch and separated from a defender. Whatever speed he's running, that's the speed he's running. And if somebody's faster, they can come and catch him, because he's not going to turn it up and run even faster. There's just one speed with Alex Collins, which is totally fine by me. You know what you're getting with this guy, which is probably why he fell to the 5th round, because they feel like he doesn't have the home run ability at the next level. But there are a bunch of 15 to 25 yard runs in his future. That is for certain. And fumbles. This is a big one, because that's a no-no. Can't put the ball, and I talked about the same thing with CJ ProSize. Can't put the football on the carpet. Can't put the church's money on the floor. 17 fumbles in his career, which is a ton. 9 of them were lost. So this is a guy that was averaging about 3 fumbles lost every year, but averaging up over 5 of them per season. So this is a huge problem for him, something he's going to have to clean up. If he can put the football away and secure it, this is a guy that I see hitting the field early on in his NFL career. That's something that will get you in the doghouse, though. He must protect the football. But in the 5th round, 171st overall selection, Arkansas running back Addis Collins for me is a triple. Love this selection. Love the team that he's going to. If they can clean up some of those issues up front along this offensive line, get stronger and stouter up there. They've got some backs now that can tote the rock in pro-size Collins. You already still have Thomas Rawls, and you even still have Christine Michael if you even want to kick those tires once again. So there are options at running back now, and I think all of them are talented in their own way. You go to the sixth round, 215th overall selection, TCU center Joey Hunt is the selection, 6 feet, 295 pounds. Quick snap to set. This is a guy that sets up shop fairly quickly. Remember, TCU, explosive offense, bunch of plays. This was a guy that was on the field for most of them. Did have an injury at the end of his last season at TCU. Did not play in the final three or four games of the season, but this is a guy that's pretty consistent. You know what you were getting out of Joey Hunt. Fundamentally sound is the next pro. I think this is a guy that you get your hands on, and with Tom Cable getting another offensive lineman, this is a guy that you don't have as much work to do with. I think this is something that you'll be able to find with this guy, that he's going to come in and be technically sound. I think his base, his hand placement, the angles that he takes to cut guys off and give out some rushing lanes is tremendous. I think he does a really good job on the double team, gets to the second level. These are all things that are pros for him. Gets to the second level with ease. I think he seals and turns defenders, so he walls them off from the ball carrier. Does a really good job of that. And I also think for his size, I was surprised. He anchors well for his size. At 6 feet, 295, I was expecting some guys to blow him up. You know, he played against some guys that were really big at TCU. But I didn't see him getting blown back very often. There was an occasional time where he would get pushed back a bit, but he would arch that back up, and he would not give any more ground. So I didn't see the pocket collapsing right before, you know, Trevon Boykins in his lap. But this was something I was surprised by, because I expected him to have some issues with some longer armed defenders who were able to get up under him before he could get his hands, because he's got short arms, as we'll talk about here in a second. Matter of fact, let's go to his cons. His size, that's the biggest issue. And he actually played guard at one point at TCU, but they moved him inside the center. Go figure with his size. 30-inch arms, not going to get it done. Okay, at the guard position. You can get away with short arms at center. You can't get away with short arms at guard. So I think because of that, that takes us to our final con. No versatility. You can't stick this guy. He can't be your backup guard. You can't stick this guy at any other position but center. And because of that limited versatility, I think he's got to make a huge impact at the center position and make it big, because if he doesn't, it's tough to keep one an offensive lineman that doesn't serve multiple roles for you on your football team, unless he's a damn good whatever it is, whether it's a guard or a center. At least if you're a guard, you can probably play both guard positions. If you're a tackle, you probably don't necessarily want to put this guy at left tackle, but in a pinch, if you had to, that guy could be a swing tackle for you. At center, and when your size is 6 feet, 295, there isn't really much more you can do other than that one position at center. So that's another question for Joey Hunt. If he's a good center, even if it's only in a backup capacity, so be it. I think he can still make a name for himself on his football team, but he's going to have to come and show that he can get it done at the center position. We'll see if he's able to do that in the sixth round, 215th overall selection. TCU center Joey Hunt for me is a double. This guy was consistent. He was solid at TCU. I don't have any complaints other than his size, which is a big issue, because with 30-inch arms, you get some big, you know, tough, physical, athletic defenders with some length that can get up under his pads. He could be in some trouble at the next level. We will see. You go to the seventh round, two seventh rounders for the Seahawks. You start with the 243rd pick in the draft. California wide receiver Kenny Lawler is a selection. 6'2", 203 pounds. Big, long target. Tremendous body control is the next pro. This is a guy that can go up, contort his body. As you can see with the arc, that was a catch with a defender draped all over him. He's leaning backwards, catching the football. Guy's got some mitts on him, make some plays. Ability to high point the football. He can go up, climb the ladder. Remember, Jared Goff was his quarterback at Cal, and I think Goff may have trusted him more so than the other receivers in situations where they got to the red zone, in situations where they needed a tough catch. He could just throw it up to Kenny Lawler and he would go make a play for him. So I think this is a guy that can go up and climb the ladder, come down with the football. He's already 6'2", has a big frame as well, and he knows how to use it, which is the next pro. He's a guy that can use his body, snatches the football out of the air. I think he has some aggressive hands Sometimes there's an issue there. We'll talk about that a little bit later on, but this is a guy that can go up and make some plays for you. Beautiful stutter to set up his routes. He's a guy that comes off the line. So not the quickest guy in the world, not the fastest guy in the world, but he's a guy that can come stutter here, set up a route, get a defender, not really knowing where he's going, and then he'll go by him, set up his route. So there's a really good job of getting into his route, creating some separation with a stutter off the line of scrimmage. And he can block. He's not a guy that is great at blocking, but he can block, get in the way, can be serviceable in that way. He can block a little bit, is what I'm trying to say. Essentially, he's not a great blocker, but he's a guy that will get in the way. You go to his cons, he's not explosive at all. At 4'6", 3", this is a guy that not going to run by anybody per se. And that's why that stutter is such a big tool for him, because he's not winning with sheer quickness. He's not winning with explosiveness. He's not outrunning anybody. His size, his ability to climb the ladder are going to be the two things that's going to really help him at the next level. He's a huge red zone target for Jared Goff, and I think that's something that could be big for him at the next level. The Utah game is the next con. He had two huge drops. Keep in mind, going into that game, Utah was 5-0, Cal was 4-0, or might have been the other way around. Either way, it's a big matchup, and Jared Goff threw 5 interceptions in that game, all in the first half, or may have even thrown 6, may have thrown 4 in the first half, and ended up with 5 at the end of the game. But I will tell you this much, one of the first interceptions, right off of Kenny Lawler's hands, it was a slant, might have scored a touchdown on it had he caught it, goes right off his hands into the defenders, and then he had a touchdown and he dropped later on in that game in the first half. They ended up not getting any points out of that in a game that they ended up losing by like, you know, 3 or 4 points. That was a huge drop. He just had a rough night, and you don't see him drop the football like that very often, but he will drop the football from time to time, and then I think it becomes a mental thing with him, so that's something to keep your eyes on. The last con is special teams value. Do you get any with this guy? Because again, as a 7th round selection, you want this guy to be able to play special teams, go down, make a tackle. He didn't do that. They didn't ask him to do that at Cal. So the question is, can he do that at the next level? I'm curious, because as a 7th round pick, if you're not playing special teams, you're probably not going to make the roster. You know what I look at Kenny Lawler as? Another one of these unheralded, unsung heroes in Seattle. We always dog the Seahawks for their receiving position because there's no alpha male there, even though I think that's about to change with Tyler Lockett. And you saw what he had in his rookie season. I think he could be a stud for you as a number one guy. But you look at Kenny Lawler, and he just strikes me as one of these guys that's going to be underappreciated, like a Doug Baldwin, like a Jermaine Kearse, a guy that just doesn't really get a lot of respect around the league, a guy that is looked down upon because he doesn't have any one attribute or trait that stands out above the rest. But yet he's going out, and in this offense, he's doing his job, which will be climbing the ladder and going up and winning some jump balls in the end zone or making some big plays down the field, because Russell Wilson scrambled around, extended the play, and then saw Kenny Lawler one-on-one with a defender and just threw it up, and Lawler goes up the ladder and goes and gets the football for a 47-yard gain. I can see him being that guy, but he's got to make this team first. And I ask the question, does he have any special teams value? We'll find out together. Right now, I'm not too sure about that. But in the 7th round, 243rd overall selection, California wide receiver Kenny Lawler for me is a double. There's a niche he can carve out for himself as a big body possession receiver that can go up and get the football. We'll see if he's able to stick on this roster or not. Again, I question his special teams value, and that could be the difference between him making his team and not making his team. And finally, in the 7th round, 247th overall selection, Clemson running back Zach Brooks is the pick. And I actually laughed at this pick when I saw it, because I said to myself, what are we doing here, Seattle? Like, literally, I said, are you that hell-bent on finding a running back with dreads that can replace Marshawn Lynch? I mean, what are we doing here? I mean, Zach Brooks is a 6'1", 200-pound running back that I think turned some heads at his pro day, running a 4.45 40, jumped a 10.9 broad, and had a 36-inch vert. So you see some explosiveness there. The speed matches up with the explosiveness. He's got a nice jump cut. He's got a really good ability to accelerate quickly. So after making that jump cut and making a guy miss, he can go from 0 to 60 real quick, get up the field, and then he's got some speed to pull away from some defenders. But and he can give you a little something in pass pro, but this guy had no production at all whatsoever at Clemson. And he had 596 yards and 5 touchdowns on 115 career carries. a total of 809 yards because he did catch the football out of the backfield a little bit, made some plays. I think of the NC State game as one of those games where he really was able to showcase some skills there. But he's not a guy with a lot of production. It's not like Clemson's been churning out world beaters at the running back position. So for him to have little to no production over the life of his career at Clemson, a little disappointing. Could have went back, played another season, decided to come out. Why? I don't know. Maybe because next year's running back class is going to be a beast. And you never know what could have happened. Wayne Gallman could have gotten injured in the offseason, and he could have gotten an opportunity to shine at Clemson. Who knows? But in any event, there's no production. There's no reason for this guy to be drafted whatsoever other than athleticism, which is what you do in the seventh round, I guess. But you already took two running backs, and you already had two guys on your roster already that could get the job done. I don't understand why you need to make a pick here. I'm thinking in this pick here, you either go offensive line, could have went linebacker, could have went defensive line again in a deep defensive line class, or you could even said, hey, we lost Ricardo Lockett to a neck injury, had to retire. He's a big special teamer for us. Let's go get a special team guy. He's not out here making special teams tackle. So I just didn't see the value here. Foot injury cost him his entire 2014 season, which is the reason why he had another year of eligibility if he would have liked to have taken it. But at the end of the day, I just saw this pick as just a, hey, let's throw a flyer on the guy, which is what you do in the seventh round. But I felt like he could have done that in a number of different positions, not running back, which is already secure for you after the selections you made in this draft. But in any event, they decided to do it. I don't see the value here with this selection because I don't see him making your squad unless he's going to go down and make some tackles on special teams, which he didn't show at Clemson. I don't understand what this pick is all about. In the seventh round, 247th pick, Clemson running back, Zach Brooks for me is a single. I don't see this guy making your team. I don't see this guy having much value unless he goes out and absolutely balls and you have an injury at the running back position and this guy shows up. I just don't see it. I know you had some injuries last year and your depth was tested at that position, but I feel like you have plenty of depth now with Collins and ProSize, Thomas Rawls from a year ago, still got Christine Michael. I'm not sure if this was a necessity here in the seventh round or not, but again, seventh round pick, I get it. You take a flyer on a height, weight, speed specimen, see what happens. I totally get it. Maybe he's not even going to play running back for you. I mean, that's what the Seahawks do, right? Take a guy at a position. Next thing you know, he's playing some other position. Who knows? But in any event, that's the Seahawks draft in a nutshell. Let's look at their picks quickly and explore them. First round, Texas A&M offensive lineman Jermaine Ifedi, triple. Second round, Alabama defensive lineman Jaron Reed, home run. Third round, CJ ProSize, running back out of Notre Dame, triple. Nick Vanette, tight end out of the Ohio State University, triple. Reese Adiambo, offensive lineman out of Boise State, double. So is Quentin Jefferson, defensive tackle out of Maryland. And then you move on to the fifth round again. Alex Collins, running back out of Arkansas, is a triple for me. Joey Hunt, TCU center, is a double. Kenny Lawler, a wide receiver out of California, is a double. And your draft is rounded out with a single by running back out of Clemson, Zach Brooks. You total this all up, home run, four triples, which nets you two triples bonuses. You have four doubles, which nets you two doubles bonuses. And then you have a single. Add all of that up, it's a 35 divided by the 10 selections made by the Seahawks in the 2016 NFL draft. And it's a 3.5 triple, another outstanding draft. This was a draft that wasn't top heavy, but there is value throughout in this draft and high level value at that. So I think this is a draft that's going to have an impact. In their rookie season, you're going to see probably three, maybe even upwards of four or five guys contributing right away from this draft. And I think at the end of the day, three, 4 years down the road, of this 10-player draft, I think seven or eight of these guys are going to be key contributors for this Seahawks football team moving forward. So it'll be interesting to see how many of these guys stick on this roster. If I had to say right now, I'm looking at Zach Brooks and I don't see much value there. Joey Hunt is another guy that I question. But other than that, I can see every single one of these guys having some kind of role with this Seahawks football team moving forward. That's the Seattle Seahawks in their 2016 NFL draft. If it happens in the National Football League, whether big or small, we cover it all here in the lab. Come back and join me as I continue to break down everything and everything in the National Football League. Who's next?
There's plenty more where that came from. While you're here, subscribe to the channel. If you want more Louis T, be sure to follow me on Twitter at In The Lab Room or You can like the Facebook page at In the Lab Room. That's In the Lab Room on Facebook and at In the Lab Room on Twitter. Don't forget, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already done so.